that was just the beginning. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Alleluia, friends. Happy Easter morning. Welcome to Hamline Church. I'm Mariah Tolgard, one of the pastors here, and we are just so, so delighted that each and every one of you are joining us here for worship here in this space, our beautiful sanctuary here in St. Paul, Minnesota, and those of you who are joining us online. We are so glad that you are with us. We have a spectacular Easter worship service in store for you. All the music we can possibly muster. I think we have over 70 musicians participating here today, and all sorts of wonderful happenings throughout the service and after, with, of course, our Easter egg hunt, and as well as our celebration downstairs with hot crust buns from the brick oven. So we are so glad that you are here to celebrate the good news of Christ's resurrection at Hamline Church. Just a couple of notes as we get started. Hopefully you've picked up an order of worship on your way in, or you can look on with a friend. If you're watching online, it is posted there as well. In bulletins that you picked up when you came in, you'll also find a pink connection card. We want to ask that everyone take a moment at some point during the service to fill that out. And there's two sides to it. On one side, you can share prayer requests that you may have, and the other side is to for more information about Hamline Church, and you can put those in the offering plates later in the service as they are passed. For those of you who are watching online, there is a link to fill out the connection card there, so we hope you'll take time to do that as well. We'll also be celebrating communion later in the service. Everyone is welcome to participate, and for those who are joining at home, you can have your communion elements ready to join in. We are especially wanting to say a welcome to anyone who is new or worshiping with us for the first time or joining us after a time away. Your presence means so much to us, and we hope that you will find our service today meaningful and uplifting. Now, my friends, let us do what the good news has called us here to do. Let us stand together and worship and proclaim our faith. Let us begin.
Let us pray together. We gather in the presence of God's love to celebrate the best love story ever told, the holy story of the risen Christ. The darkness is gone, bright light. Those who went to the tomb received the good news.
Christ is not there.
Christ is risen in our hearts and in our spirits.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can clap if you want. There was a lot of clapping. That was beautiful. Amen, amen. Beloveds in Christ, God's love pours out from the grave of despair. The risen one comes with hands full of love, greeting us with peace the world does not know, giving us peace that the world cannot give. Alleluia. Christ's peace is ours forever. Now let us greet one another with the Easter peace. The peace of the risen Christ be with you all. Amen. Peace of Christ.
Friends, as you greet one another, I want to invite any children who would like to join us to come on up to the steps. Come on up. Good morning. Come find a spot. Welcome, welcome. Look at all these friends. Happy Easter. Happy Easter. I'm so glad y'all are here. We got some spots. Yeah, come on up. We can scoot over. Can you all scoot one way or the other to make a little more room for our friends? Look at all these friends. There's a spot right there. Alexander, you can sit right there in front of Vincent. Welcome. Oh, my goodness. Let's see. Willa, can you scoot a little bit? And we got, yep, you can go all the way to the top step. Go to the top step. Oh my gosh, this is amazing. Look at all these friends. Or you can just sit, if you just want to sit right where you are, that's okay too. You want to sit right here with me, Isabel? Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Good, great. I'm so glad. I'm Katie and I know a lot of you, but if I don't know you, I'm glad you're here. It's good to see you. And I work with the children and youth here. A couple of reminders for you all and for your families. Today, we have a lot of ways you can participate. If you are five and under, we have a nursery down the hall with our childcare staff. We are all going to stay in worship together today because it's such a special service, and we have communion later also. We have lots of materials over by the door. Maybe some of y'all found them as you came in. We've got books and fidgets and coloring materials, all sorts of things that you can get. We have a quieter space in the chapel if you need a little bit of quieter space. So all sorts of ways that you can participate today. And today is an exciting day because it's Easter Sunday. It's Easter Sunday, yeah. And you know what we remember on Easter Sunday is that God said, "My love is stronger than death," which is kind of amazing, right? We move through this week with a really sad story about Jesus' death. And then today we remember that God said, "Nope, my love is stronger than all of that." Yeah, you can come sit right here. And so there are a couple of ways that we remember this story, and maybe you've seen some of these images or ideas before. I want to show you a few things. You may have gotten, as you came in, this bulletin, which is just for you all, and this has some stickers inside. So here, you can create the story of Easter morning. So there's more over here by the commons if you didn't get one, or I can help you find one. Okay, and this has pictures of Jesus and of the women who went to take care of his body on Easter morning. And so that's one way we remember this story. Another thing you might have seen before, a lot of times at Easter we have butterflies around. And if you know about butterflies, if you've learned about them before, their life cycle reminds us of new life and of resurrection in some ways. And so all of you will get a sticker, this sticker later today, and it says, Alleluia. Okay, and there's also butterfly coloring sheets over there as well. And then another thing that sometimes we could use to remember this Easter story, what is this here?
An egg.
But something is a little bit different about this egg. I want to show you. What's inside?
Nothing.
Air. And that's a little bit unusual, right?
Air.
That's true. So let me tell you, today these eggs are reminding us of the Easter story in another way. Because when the women went to find Jesus and take care of his body, they went to where he was buried, and the stone was moved, and he wasn't in there. It was empty. And so these eggs can remind us of that empty tomb, and that Jesus was not there. And that's the amazing news in the story that we know at Easter, on Easter Sunday. It is a sad story. It's confusing and sad and amazing all at the same time. Yeah, and that's what we're celebrating today, exactly. And so if you all want to celebrate with us after worship today, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt. And so a couple of instructions about that. If you are 4 and under, you're going to hunt on the lawn. So you can go out those doors to the left. 5 and up, you're going to hunt on the greenway. I've got some youth volunteers and helpers who are helping us. And guess what? The eggs that you find, they're going to be empty. But when you go, once you get your eggs, you can go into the community room downstairs and exchange them for some treats. Okay? So I hope that you'll join us for that after worship. And now, in just a moment, some of you are going to lead us in some music. Some of you have been practicing. Yeah. And so first, before we move to that, we're going to pray together. And then if you are not singing, you can come sit over here with me, okay? And we're going to experience this song together, and then we'll all go back to our seats. And as you go back to your seats, I have some bags for you, and you can use these for the egg hunt. And if you want to decorate them with the stickers or with some art that reminds you of Easter Sunday, you can do that during the service, okay? So don't forget. I might forget, so you got to help me remember. We're going to give you some bags before you go back to your seats, okay? So will you pray with me before we do our music? You can repeat after me. Dear God, dear God, thank you for joyful days. Thank you for joyful days. Help us to remember, help us to remember the power of your love, power of your love, and share it with others. Share it with others. Amen. All right, friends, so if you're singing, you're going to go up here to your spots, and if you're not singing, you can come down here with me. You can come right down here.
mom.
Amen. All right, friends, you can come get a bag from me or Pastor Heather and then go back to your seats with your family, okay?
Today's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they could go and anoint Jesus' dead body. Very early on, the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they came to the tomb. They were saying to each other, "Who's going to roll the stone away from the entrance for us?" When they looked up, They saw the stone had rolled away, and it was a very large stone. Going into the tomb, they saw a young man in a white robe seated on the right side, and they were startled. But he said to them, "Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He isn't here. Look, here's the place where they laid him. Go, tell his disciples, especially Peter, that he is going ahead of you into Galilee. You will see him there, just as he told you." Overcome with terror and dread, they fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Drew, and thank you, Kids Choir. That was fantastic. You all sounded amazing. Thank you for leading us. Now, did you catch that ending? Could you see how that wrapped up there? And they said nothing to anyone. The end. Happy Easter. If this were a show on Netflix, we would let the next episode start playing. Of course, we'd want to continue watching, and we'd want to find out what happens next. Three women go to the tomb early in the morning, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome. All three women had stayed with Jesus throughout his crucifixion in Jerusalem. They had watched and waited. They were there when he breathed his last and when he died. They saw where he was buried, and they saw the huge stone placed in front of the tomb. Now, we don't know fully why they went or what they were expecting to find, but early that morning, they went to the tomb anyway. And to their astonishment, the stone was rolled away. And inside, there was no body. Instead, they find a young man who proclaims, "He is risen, he is not here," preaching the first Easter sermon that would ever be heard. And in response, the women flee in terror and amazement. Were we watching this on Netflix, there would not be a next episode to play. Instead, it would do that thing where when your show ends, your series ends, and then they suggest a new show that they think you might like, right? And they start playing something because the algorithm thinks that this would be something you'd be into. So here, perhaps all of a sudden, Survivor Gospel Edition would come on. And there'd be the 12 disciples who are in hiding when suddenly a resurrected Savior glides through locked doors. Or maybe it would suggest Amazing Race, featuring Jesus appearing to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and then to Saul on the Damascus Road, imparting clues or words of wisdom. Or maybe the algorithm would have gone in a different direction entirely, thinking you needed something a little bit lighter, and would have started playing, "Is it cake? Is it the stone from the empty tomb? Or just chocolate cake with a lot of fondant frosting?" Well, I think you would probably, have you ever had this happen where then you check back and go back to the menu in Netflix to make sure you hadn't missed that a new season came out, or maybe looked up to see perhaps a new season would be coming out soon? But nope, not for Mark's version of the story. His series would be done. Well, except for the fact that years later, some scholars were so uncomfortable with this seemingly incomplete ending that they would come along and do a couple of spin-off episodes to draw a more satisfying conclusion, where the disciples do, in fact, encounter Jesus and do go and tell the good news everywhere. If you want to see that end of the story, you can open your Bibles right now and look it up. However, in Mark's gospel, as the writer originally intended it, the risen Christ is not a starring character, just an empty tomb. Yet if you were listening closely, there was something more. This wasn't actually the end. There was a clue, really a promise, about what was to come. Again, the young man, Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Mark gives us a story that leaves its conclusion unwritten, because his intention is that it is to be completed in the lives of those who hear or read it or watch it on Netflix. He urges his hearers and readers to journey back to Galilee, to the familiar place where it all began. He invites them to go back to the beginning and to see things anew with all that they know now from years of ministry with Jesus. And he encourages them to embrace the mission that Jesus had started, of confronting the forces of darkness, of comforting the afflicted, of healing the sick, of sharing life together. For in doing the ministry that they too are called to do, that is where they will see the risen Christ. Friends, Mark did not see this moment as an ending, but instead a beginning. The story of what God is doing in and through Jesus isn't over at the empty tomb, you see. It's only just getting started. Resurrection isn't a conclusion, it's an invitation. And Jesus' triumph over death, sin, and hate isn't what Mark's gospel is all about. Rather, Mark's gospel is all about setting us up to live resurrection lives and to continue the story of God's redemption of the world. And here we are. This morning, we, like the women, stand outside the empty tomb. And we too are being called to live the resurrection forward. This is more than just proclaiming, "Alleluia, Christ is risen." I mean, you still have to do your part because we were working on the call and response thing. So, "Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia." Yeah, good. We still have to do that, but it is more than that. It requires embracing uncertainty, taking risks, trusting without tangible evidence, and actively embodying resurrection in the midst of ongoing challenges and struggles in the face of continued death. And maybe in the midst of a world full of bad news, that a world that seems plagued with heavy, unsolvable, heart-breaking challenges, wars raging in the Holy Land, climate disasters, famine in Southwest Asia and Northern Africa, a rising tide of dangerous Christian nationalism, not to mention crippling rates of gun violence right here in our own city. Maybe in response to all of this, maybe in response to the state of our world, instead of always asking, "Well, who will roll away the stone for us?" there is power. There is possibility. There is hope in saying the story isn't over. But then that also means, oh, the story isn't over. Maybe this is why the women that morning were so scared at the tomb. If the story isn't over with Jesus' death, then all of those challenging instructions that he gave to them about living in God's kingdom here and now were still true. The reality of the resurrection became real as they translated belief into action, following the teachings and examples of Jesus. As they began to embody his ways, they learned to trust their own abilities, guided by their own hands, their own hearts and their own minds. Take heart, my friends. You are already a part of the resurrection story. You have already been starting this story anew through God's redeeming work. I see it in you and in this church all the time. I see it in the hard work we've been doing this Lent of rending our hearts, reckoning with the history of this land that was stolen from Dakota people. The work isn't over, we know. It's just the beginning. As we look to what does repair and reconciliation look like with Indigenous people and with God's creation. I see it in our partnership with Emma Norton Services as we support them as they take on the seemingly impossible plight of ending homelessness in our city. Just recently, I was blessed to hear many of the residents speak at a closing dinner as they move from their current location downtown St. Paul to their new location, Restoring Waters in Highland Bridge. Many of the residents spoke and shared stories of their own resurrection, overcoming illness, addiction, abusive relationships. When they found Emma Norton Services, they found hope and healing through community and supportive staff. And of course, for many, it wasn't always a neat and easy upward journey. It had stops and starts. But through life and community, they had the foundation they needed for their new beginnings. I see it in this congregation's yes to becoming a mobile shelter. In the face of an overwhelming global epidemic of unprecedented numbers of refugees and displaced persons, tomorrow, this church will open our doors to asylum seekers, to families who have left situations so bad and so dire in their home country that they felt their lives and their children's lives were on the line. And so they journeyed, many of them coming north and landing at the southern borders, where they were then bused up to northern cities, and now are looking to start life anew. Having seen the worst of humanity and all politics aside, might the warm welcome and shelter and hospitality that Hamline Church can offer play a small part in assuring them that their story too is just beginning and that new life is possible. And lastly, I see it in this church's profound proclamation of welcome and inclusion to the LGBTQIA+ community for the last 25 years. And I see it in the ongoing commitment to change both within the church and in society at large. By the way, happy Transgender Day of Visibility. We see you, we love you, and above all else, God loves you. Friends, it's only the beginning. This story isn't over. It's only the beginning, and we have a part to play. It's only the beginning, and if you wonder why there is still so much distress and pain in the world, it's because God's not done yet. Just a note, I know that there are many among us this day who are struggling with heartache and pain in their own lives, whether it be dealing with a difficult diagnosis, journeying with an aging parent or loved one, living with the heaviness of grief, feeling overburdened by stress at work or at school or with the economics of the world today. And I want you to hear me say that the promise of resurrection continues in you too. that Jesus goes ahead of you, and do not be afraid to begin again. The risen Christ will meet you there. I assure you that your healing and your healing and your healing and my healing, for we all are in need of healing. I assure you that our healing is inextricably linked to the healing and wholeness of those around us, of our neighbors. And it is a story that we must write together. For resurrection is not simply something that happened 2,000 years ago. It is happening today. Every time we choose to stand and walk together in courage, in faith, and in love. Mark pulls us right up to the edge of the empty tomb and leaves us with a choice. To let the Netflix algorithm do its thing and take us on some kind of wild ride, or to start our own new series. To return to the hard work before us, to take up with our own hands the work that Christ began, to bear in our own bodies, with our own voices, and in our own life together, the hope of new life, of human dignity, of the fullness that God wishes for all of us. We are empowered and equipped to work for good in every circumstance. We are assured that Jesus goes ahead of us, showing us the way, and we are fueled by our faith in God's promises that all will in time come to a good end, even when we can't see evidence of that. For as the choir will sing in just a moment, a new Jerusalem arise, a new creation come alive into the dawning after dark. God is making all things new. Friends, it's only the beginning, and the rest, perhaps even the best of this story, is unfolding before our eyes and indeed through our lives, for that is where we find the risen Christ. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Alleluia.
Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard, nor the cry of distress. God will dwell with the people and will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. And God said, "See, I am making all things new."
Choir, outstanding. Thank you. Thank you. You have set the invitation to the table. For we are reminded that when we come to this table, this is not my table or Heather's table or Hamline Church's table, but this is the table of God. As a member of Hamline Church and a retired United Methodist pastor in our community, Delton Kruger, recently reminded me, when we come to this table, when we share in communion together, we recreate the heart of Jesus. And that is what we are invited to do today as we begin the resurrection story again. Those of you who will be joining us in communion at home, please have your elements ready for later, bread or cracker and juice or whatever beverage that you have. Friends, if you are here in this space, you are welcome at this table. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for the feast.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One, our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We thank you, God, for out of darkness you brought light. Out of the dust of the earth you made us in your image. You made covenant to be our God. And out of slavery you came and set us free. You are the one who brought Christ out of death to life, who brings life out of hopelessness, joy out of despair. You bring us out of our small lives to share in your big joy. Therefore, we sing your praise with all creation. Blessed is Jesus, your Christ. He loved and taught and healed, and by word and miracle showed us your grace, rising always out of doubt and fear. For his nonviolent acts against the power of oppression, he was killed. But you, God, raised him up, affirmed his love, and brought him victory over death itself.
When we gather at this sacred table, we remember. The night when Jesus gave himself up for us, he ate and broke the bread with his friends. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Remember me every time you do this."
And after they had eaten, he took the cup and said, "Remember me as you drink from this, for it is my life poured out for you. The beginning of a new creation." Gracious God, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim together the mystery of our faith.
Christ.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup, that they may be for us the body and love of our Lord Jesus the Christ. Raise up your Holy Spirit in us, that with Christ's love living in us, we might be the body of Christ raised to new life, unafraid of death, with gentle courage to love the world. In the name and the company and the Spirit of the living Christ, all glory and honor is yours, loving God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Now let us all, called and empowered by God, to join with Christ in prayer as he taught us, each using the words and language that is most meaningful for you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever.
Amen. Friends, this is God's table. Again, everyone, without exception, may have communion. We are going to do this very smoothly, I promise. We have 7 stations. We're going to have 2 stations at the front and 2 at the back, where there's a break in the middle. Everyone behind that break will go to the back. We have servers for the transept and servers coming up to the balcony, who will then go over to the handbells, and servers for you all as well in the choir. Friends, everyone is welcome at this table. If you are taking communion at home, we invite you to serve and feast and say the bread of life and the cup of everlasting love. The ushers will dismiss you. Please come. All is ready. There are gluten-free options here at the front and at the back station as well. Let us feast together.
beautiful. Thank you, Brass. Friends, let us together give thanks. Thank you, God, for life in the Spirit of Jesus, for gladness in this bread and cup, for love that cannot die, for peace the world cannot give, for joy in the company of friends, for the splendors of creation, and for the mission of justice you have made our own. Give us the gifts of this holy communion, oneness of heart, love for neighbors, forgiveness of enemies, the will to serve you every day, and the risen life that never ends. In Christ's name we pray, alleluia, amen.
We have just feasted together at the table of the risen Christ. Alleluia. 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 Let's try. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
All right. In response, with glad and grateful hearts, we take the first steps of continuing to live in the resurrection story by giving back to God and help bring hope, healing, and new life to others. Hamline Church has a tradition of taking a special offering on Easter to benefit ministry partners who are at the front lines of healing a broken world. This year's offerings support UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief, and Emma Norton, Restoring Waters. These two recipients represent our commitment to caring for our global and local neighbors. UMCOR provides relief, response, and long-term recovery aid around the world when disaster events overwhelm a community's ability to recover on their own. Here in St. Paul, our longtime ministry partner, Emma Norton Services, is nearing the completion of their new location. Restoring Waters is a 60-unit transformational housing community that provides a place for individuals and families who have experienced trauma and hopelessness and there they will require supportive services. Your generosity will help share the love of Jesus Christ with all of God's people. There are several ways to give. There's envelopes in the pews that can be placed in one of the offering plates as they are passed. There are offering boxes near the exits. You can mail a check to the office, you can give online, or you can give by text. Also, please put your connection cards in the offering plates or use the links posted on Facebook and YouTube. Now, let us give with joyful hearts.
We invite you to sing along with us if you'd like to on Morning Has Broken.
Complete now.
Amen, amen. See how I just emerged like I had been playing along with the band back there? I really hadn't. We are so grateful for all of the wonderful music that has been a part of our worship today. I just want to stop and take a minute to make a few announcements about things that are happening in the life of Hamline Church. As I mentioned in the sermon, starting tomorrow, we are hosting a mobile shelter here as part of Faithful Hospitality with Interfaith Action of Greater St. Paul. If you would like to sign up to volunteer to spend a night at Hamline Church, we are still looking for some volunteers, especially later into May. We are hosting in April and May, and so on-the-job training is provided. There's lots of resources out there to help you to learn more and more information online. So please consider spending a night and helping us open the church to these friends and neighbors. Also, if you are interested in membership at Hamline Church, if you are looking for a church home, we would be delighted to be yours. We have a couple of events coming up later this month, including a new member inquiry class and welcome dinner that will be on April 14th. And you can talk to me or Pastor Heather if you'd like more information about that or like more information about how to get connected at Hamline Church. Lastly, reminder on the Easter egg hunt, I can sense the anticipation building. We are going to have the littlest ones are going to head out to the front lawn and over to the playground where the grass is always green on the playground. So that is for 4 and under, and then 5 and older are going to go around to the greenway here on the east side of the building to find their eggs. And remember, the eggs are empty because we continue the story. And you can claim your prizes downstairs in the community room. All right, we have something big still yet to come. David, are you ready? Are they ready? Are we ready?
I think so. I'd like to invite the brass and the choir to come forward. So as tradition for hundreds of years, people often stand for the performance of the Alleluia Chorus from George Frederick Handel's Messiah, and we have put some pamphlets of the music in the pews for you. They're small. They're next to the offering envelopes. So if you know this piece and like to sing along with us, you're welcome to do that. you're welcome also to stand. So there's this legend that in 1743, when the King George II first heard this performed in London, he was so moved by it that he just stood up. And so it's become a tradition ever since. This piece is performed for a lot of occasions, but it is for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But it was also performed in the signing of the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863 in Boston on New Year's Day. So celebratory piece. We'd like for you to celebrate with us today as we perform it. So please stand as you're able and sing if you like and enjoy all the sounds around you.
Thank you.
Alleluia. Amen. Thank you all. Thank you. I'm pretty sure I sing along with every single part there at some point. What a blessing and joy it has been to celebrate together. Friends, thank you for being here, for sharing your Easter with us. A huge, huge thank you to all who have been a part of putting this service together. We've had likely 100 different folks having their hands in this in some way, and a special huge thanks to all of our musicians for all the time and effort and energy that you've put in. We have seen the risen Christ in you. Friends, we invite you now to head outside for, what are we doing out there? Easter egg hunt! They're screaming it from the balconies, yes! And to join us now downstairs for a time of coffee and refreshments on a beloved tradition of Hamline Church, we have hot cross buns from the brick oven. But there is sort of a double finale here because we have Vidor Staccato from the organ, so you will want to hear that as well. Yes. So hear these words, friends, as we go. May the living God who raised Jesus from the dead bless you and keep you and make you shine with joy. May God raise up new life in you and give you peace for the sake of Jesus, Lord of life.
Christ has risen. Tell the world.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Christ is risen. Tell the world.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Christ is risen. Tell the world.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Amen. Go in peace.